My purpose is to reinvent and modernize corporate organizations. Isn't it fascinating that although our whole world has changed within the last 100 years, we are still operating in the similar structure like we had 100 years ago. But now, with digitization massively kicking in, there's no other chance than to reinvent corporate cultures. All data is there. Employees can control themselves. We don't need a Mr. Know-it-all controlling freak at the top to control these guys. And definitely, now we have to change for this. The other thing is we have a large talent gap. High potentials can choose the employer of choice for them, and they will choose a company where they are able to thrive, where they can be in a flow every now and then. And you need a flow to be innovative. Definitely not a culture of fear like we have seen for some nice German companies in the past. I'm a wanderer between very different worlds, have worked in the US, in Japan, Switzerland, and Germany, and managed large HR functions for General Electric, Beiersdorf, Daimler, UBS, and others. But I also understand the corporate startup world, and I have studied these small speedboats and tried to find out the benchmarks. What are the best practices that we can implement also for large corporates? And I'm consulting large corporates today on the best innovative culture. And I can tell you, this is a long way. If they are on an innovation culture scale of a 10, they are at a 3. It takes at least 2 years until they get to a 5 and probably 5 years until they make it to a 7. What is typically at the moment, and what I'm consulting typically, is ambidexterity. That we have a dualism of two worlds. One is the operational stuff with the bread and butter profitable business, the cash cow, and on the other side, the innovation area that has to be a network organization where people can act more agile, where every 3 or 4 months the project will change and certainly leadership is changing. And at the moment, most of the companies are doing an 80-20 rule or something. This innovation area will grow bigger and bigger, and there will be something in between. It's a fascinating time at the moment to be in that spot. For my last book, I did some research and came up with 20 megatrends that influence us in the workplace until 2025. Most of these will be familiar to you. I would like to focus today just on 3 of them: workforce demographics, repurpose, and robotics and automatization. The first one, workforce demographics, will not surprise you. Silver agers have been discriminated in the past massively. And what is missing at the moment is an individualized career path for them. Some of them would like to retire with 57, but lots of them can work and are willing and able to work until they're 75. Probably as consultants, 20%, 40%, whatever. With this massive talent gap that we have, we cannot afford to neglect them any further. Second, female shift, no surprise. The discussion was a little bit too superficial in the past. We were just focusing on the few board members that we have seen, but we need to build up the middle management as well for females and other diverse work groups that they are able and capable to take over board positions pretty soon. We need more diversity in the board. Next one, robotics and automatization. Did you ever come across a study of Frey and Osborne 2013? Interesting one. They postulated that in 2025, 47% of all US jobs will be made redundant. The surprising thing is, it's not about the number. Let's see if it's 20, 30, or 40%. The surprising thing is, it's the first time that academic jobs seem to be at risk. And this is pretty dangerous, I would say. Everywhere where standardization and scaling is possible, standardization will happen and jobs will be made redundant. Journalism, journalists. The New York Post is publishing articles for lots of years with artificial intelligence. Not too bad. They will be better. Same about lawyers. Insurance companies are doing the contracting most of the time by artificial intelligence. This is growing bigger and bigger. So you can say, if there are lots of exceptions to the rule with your job and scaling and standardization is not possible, you might be in a safe spot, but you never know. Real purpose looks esoteric. You probably all know Abraham Maslow's hierarchy of needs. I was taught only 1% of our population reaches self-fulfillment. But every second person is asking me for that. When people are searching for a job, most of them really want self-fulfillment. And there is a huge gap between job aspirations and job offers of companies. This is something to take care of. I recommend each corporate really to look at the real purpose, the bigger why. What makes them not only successful, but what is the bigger purpose why they are existing? And this is a clear managerial task, a leadership task, making it clear to each employee. You will never reach, if you don't encourage the heart, you will never reach the full potential of your employees. Very, very important for the future. Let's have a short look at the different generations in the workplace. Why is everybody talking about Generation Y? Are they so different? Only partly. 30% of them are still very career-oriented. 20% of them are security-oriented, want a safe job. But about 50% of them are autonomy-driven, purpose-driven. They are asking for the purpose, and they want constant feedback by their managers. They want to learn. They want to thrive. This is different. And they would challenge authority if they do not learn enough from their managers. They will leave. And that becomes interesting. Same Generation Z, too early to say how they are, but I assume they are pretty similar. So it will be a tough time for the old manager type who is not giving feedback enough, is not really doing talent management, and is not developing employees to the right extent. I would like to recommend 10 guiding principles for organizations how to build up the perfect corporate culture. First, holistic philosophy and real purpose. This is something you cannot delegate. They have to clarify what is important for us, what is the bigger why, are we doing what we are doing. Corporate values. Did you ever compare corporate values of different organizations? Sometimes they're extremely interchangeable. It's fun. If they are not authentic and individual, you can save the paper you write it on. It's not a marketing campaign. It's not a communication campaign. Important is the discussion about values. It is important, really, that everybody can be engaged and that you discuss, what does it mean for leadership? Why are we doing this? Why is it so special about us? In the last time, performance management was discussed a lot. Performance management means typically you have an annual cycle. At the beginning of the year, you do your goals together with your supervisor as an employee. And at the end of the year, my boss tells me, Jan, this year you did a mediocre job. On a 5 scale, you get a 3, and you get 5% more bonus, and was okay. Have a great day. This was the past. This doesn't work anymore. So most of the consulting companies skipped the ratings and the grading in performance management because they realized they failed. It doesn't help. Important, my recommendation, are the feedback discussions. You should have at least 4 formal feedback discussions each year and put the employee development into the center. But that means you need very different managers than of the past. You need managers who can coach, managers who are able to give feedback, and feedback always should happen pretty timely. You cannot wait a whole year until you tell your employee what he has done half a year ago or something. That doesn't work at all. You need another manager type for the future. And each company should look into, what can we learn from something? The famous Google Award, the Penguin Award, is a good one. Each month they are discussing each failed project. And it's not about putting the project leader discriminating this guy, but really, what can we learn from this failed project? What can the organization learn? It's all about learning. Companies will not exist if they don't have a learning orientation for the future. Decisions should be made on the expert level, people who are able to decide. It doesn't need to be decided always by the board. You will lose speed and agility if that doesn't happen. It takes definitely too long. And digitization needs new structures. I mentioned already the ambidexterity, but it also needs completely different leaders. we will see where this ends up to. But I also see examples where leadership is rotating. We sometimes have democratic examples where the CEO is voted by the whole population of the company. And some of them do not exist in the future. There's a lot going on. It requires new leaders. I call this mindful leadership. You need leaders who have confident humility and professional willingness, but they should be mindful with themselves and with others. You don't need typically the expert leader at the top. It's a completely different management type, exactly also for this for the Generation Y. Let's have a short look at the different office spaces that we have. Why are Apple, Facebook, and Google doing this? Why are they investing so much into their office spaces? They are doing a pretty good job because employees can be in a flow. They are taken care of. Food 24/7 at Google, they are picked up by buses in the morning, Wi-Fi all the time. They can fully concentrate on their jobs. This is very helpful, and this is something also companies that don't have the capital like Google should do something similar. The other good thing is that they create places to mingle between the different divisions and silos. When Steve Jobs rejoined Apple, he brought all the bathroom facilities to the center of the headquarters that people could mingle and talk to each other. Not sure if I recommend this, but you need to create spaces where people can exchange ideas and really tear down the silos. That is pretty important. Last one, massively invest in talent management. Have managers at the top who are thinking about development of the employees all the time. Develop them for the organization, that the organization can be more stable and stronger for the future. Thank you so much.